Hi, my name is Paul Rashidi, and I'm with the Google Cloud Platform team. Today we're going to discuss how to build the Hello Endpoints Android application from scratch. We'll be helped by a GitHub gist that will contain most of the code we would normally write and comment it in as we talk about it. So let's get started. The first step we'll take is setting up a Cloud Endpoints backend. This is actually pretty easy. We clone a Cloud Endpoints backend sample from GitHub like this, but do note there is also a Python version available as well. In order to get the Java backend running on our local machine, we'll perform two steps. We'll uncomment a line in this Maven pom XML file to specify that we want to run on all IP addresses on the local machine. This will allow our Android application to access the backend application, since we'll be using an emulator which can't access localhost. The other change we'll need to make is editing the App Engine Web XML file to update the AppSpot ID. Since we won't be deploying remotely to App Engine, this ID is only affecting the Java package name of our generated classes. You should use the developer console to register an ID and use that value here. Easy enough, we'll save and exit. So, just to quickly recap, we only made these two changes. Now to run this backend locally, we will invoke it via Maven. In this command, install is building our application, and the dev server command is running it on a local dev server. You should know the first time you run this command on a machine, it will take a little bit longer than normal because Maven will download the App Engine plugin. Now that our server is running, let's take a look at it in our API Explorer. This is very handy if you're not familiar with an API but still want to play around with it. We'll use this URL. We'll select our API and we'll run the list command here. We see that our service is returning two messages. Hello world and goodbye world. Now that we have a working test server, let's get to the Android app. We'll switch to Android Studio to create our project. The first thing we're going to do is create a new Android application via the new project wizard. We'll adjust some project names here and then select a minimum API level of 8. The client libraries that we will create will need this minimum level. We'll take the rest of the defaults and create this project. I'll speed the video up a little so you don't have to wait for the initial build. And there we have it. This is the typical default Android project with a single main activity. We'll just close a few windows here and put focus on our GitHub gist. This gist contains all the code that we are writing during this tutorial, so you don't have to watch me type. You can access this gist at the URL on the screen. Let's just briefly look at the files before we copy them into our project. First, we have application.java, which we'll use as a way to store messages retrieved from our backend API. You will want to use a content provider instead of a global variable like this, but we're doing this for sample code simplicity. The next file is the main activity file. All the code pertaining to connecting to the backend API is commented out. The code that is not commented out implements a simple list adapter that will let us display messages on the screen retrieved from the backend API. The next XML file defines the GUI for the app. We'll preview this in a minute. This file contains a snippet of Gradle dependencies we'll use to complement our client library classes. This final file is a simple move script that will move these files into the right locations in our sample project. So now we'll flip over to a new terminal window and download this gist. We'll also enable permissions and execute our move script. And now the files we reviewed are in our project. We'll first take a look at the main activity code we glossed over before. You can see the import statements for the client library are throwing an error. That's because we need to generate our client library. Let's do that now. To do this, we'll flip back to our terminal window. We'll stop our backend API server, and we'll run this endpoints get client lib goal via Maven. This will generate the client library. Next, we'll move the zip file containing the generated Java classes to our current directory. Then we'll unzip it and move it to our Android project source directory. Then we'll restart our local backend API server. We'll now switch back to Android Studio and reference this Gradle build file dependency snippet. We're going to copy this and paste it into the build Gradle file for our project. This will put all the dependencies that the generated client library code needs into our project so that we can build and run. We'll now save and force a rebuild of the project. If you still have some unresolved imports, you likely need to run the sync project with Gradle function here. Next, we're going to look at the GUI layout that we received from our gist. It's a simple layout with a simple button for our backend, for each of the API methods. First, we can get a message by ID. You'll notice we use the onClick attribute to dynamically invoke methods in our code. Next, we have a button to list all the greetings on the server. Here we have a send greeting button, which maps to the multiply message on the backend. Finally, in this UI, you'll notice a list view at the bottom, which we'll use to display our messages. You probably also noticed the sign in button and the authenticated message buttons. We won't talk about those in this video, but full details are in the README of the full sample code I referenced at the beginning of the video. We'll now close this and go back to our main activity code. The first code we're going to comment in is the onClickListGreeting method. This method is invoked when the ListGreetings button is clicked on the GUI we just looked at. You'll see we're using an anonymously defined async task to make our backend API calls. On that background thread, we are first getting a handle to our backend API via this utility method. We'll then create a ListGreeting command object, and we immediately invoke it to retrieve a greeting. We pass the retrieved greeting back from the method, and then it's passed back to us in the onPostExecute method right here. In this method, we'll use the displayGreetings utility to display it in our UI. This line of code then kicks off this anonymously defined async task without any parameters. We'll next uncomment onClickGetGreeting to implement getGreeting button functionality. This looks the same as before, except we're getting the greeting ID parameter from the UI here. We format it for use in our API call, and then we use the async task here again. Finally, we'll comment in the onClickSendGreetings method to implement the last button. The only real difference here is that we're pulling two parameters from the UI instead of one, as before. Now we'll take a look at some of the utility code we used above. This first method is the one we use to get a handle to our backend API. We're constructing a builder object that was supplied by the generated API classes. We're using two class variables here to construct our builder. Let's comment those in above. As you can see, we're commenting in Android compatible, JSON factory, and an HTTP transport. Let's scroll back down. In this builder, we have the capability of providing a different root URI. This is a handy way of redirecting your client library to point to your local development or testing servers. We're going to do that right now with my IP address. This is so any API calls we make will go against my local development server from the Android emulator. The final code we'll comment in here is the displayGreetings method. This method simply updates our list adapter to display the greetings passed to it. Again, you typically want to use content providers to store and provide data to list adapters, but we are simplifying this sample code. The code down here is the list adapter we saw earlier in the GitHub gist. Nothing new. We're close to being finished, I promise. Next, we'll add internet permissions to our Android manifest file. We'll adjust our UI style to be dark instead of the light one. This will make our content a little bit more visible when we run it in the emulator. We're about done. Let's go ahead and start an emulator. We click here and create an emulator. Any will do unless you've added authentication to your API. And in that case, you would need to select a Google API's emulator. We'll start this emulator, and I'll scale it so it fits on the screen. Remember to utilize the accelerator extension in the SDK manager if it is available for your development platform. Okay, now that we're up and running with the emulator, let's make one last change. We need to define our custom application class in our Android manifest. I'll do that really quick here, and then we'll deploy to our emulator. Whew, it's running. All right, the first thing we'll test is list greeting. We click the button, and we can see hello and goodbye world messages. These are the same messages we saw when we used the API Explorer before. Now we'll test get greeting by putting in an index of 0, and it returns the correct hello world greeting from the backend API. The ID of 1 returns the goodbye greeting correctly as well. Then we'll test send greetings by putting in a text message and specify that it needs to be repeated 3 times. And the backend API successfully returned our message here as well. Well, that's about it. Our tests are working, and our new Android application is communicating with an API we're running on our local server. I want to thank you all for your time. The Google Cloud Platform team looks forward to seeing what you build with this, and we look forward to your feedback as well. Thanks.